Between the discovery of gravity waves on Pluto and radioactive interstellar rain on Earth, there's a whole lot of atmospheric science to talk about this week. So let's start with everyone's favorite dwarf planet. After analyzing some photos from the New Horizons spacecraft, NASA scientists say that there's evidence of gravity waves in Pluto's atmosphere, which had only been detected on Earth and Mars before. But wait, let me be clear. These gravity waves aren't the same thing as gravitational waves. You know, the ones we just managed to see for the first time a few months ago? Whoever named this stuff really didn't make it easy. Gravitational waves are created when large objects like stars move around in space, causing energy ripples in space-time itself, which you can imagine like ripples on the surface of a lake after something like a boat goes through. Gravity waves, on the other hand, are the actual ripples that a boat makes in an actual lake here on Earth. To make gravity waves, all you need is a place where two fluids with different densities are touching, like air and water. Since air can flow, it's considered a fluid in physics. So when the lake water is still, the force of gravity pulling the air down is balanced by the water's force of buoyancy pushing up. But when a boat speeds through it, it pushes the water in front of it up a bit. The force of gravity pulls the water back down, trying to restore balance, but the water ends up below the original surface level. The buoyancy pushes that water back up, but it gives the water so much momentum that it overshoots and ends up back above the original surface level. And then the whole thing repeats so that you get a section of the water moving up and down, and that's a gravity wave. And waves in water are just one way to visualize gravity waves. When a layer of air is pushed over mountains, which causes the initial bump and interacts with a colder, denser layer of air, it can create those rippling clouds, another form of gravity wave. And these gravity waves have been seen in the atmospheres of Earth and Mars, but not on any other planets. At least not until the New Horizons team noticed hazy layered structures moving up and down in Pluto's skies, which they think are because of gravity waves. So even though New Horizons passed by Pluto last July, we're still learning a ton from it. So now let's move on to that radioactive rain. A few weeks ago, an international team of scientists published a study about detecting the radioactive remnants of faraway stars at the bottom of Earth's oceans. And just last week, a new paper suggested that these radioactive elements may still be raining down on Earth, just very slowly. When a star much bigger than ours reaches the end of its life, it dies in a fantastic explosion called a supernova and sprays its guts into the surrounding cosmos. Most of this stuff is hydrogen or helium, since those make up most of the star, but there's also some heavier elements that the star synthesized in its core right before exploding, like a radioactive form of iron called iron-60, which was recently found deep in the Earth's crust. So how did it get there? The international team of scientists reported that the iron-60 might have come from a series of relatively recent nearby supernovae, which would have exploded sometime between 1.7 and 3.2 million years ago. This means that the Earth was bombarded by dust and gamma rays from supernovae right around the last ice age. These researchers also found evidence of iron-60 from at least one other supernova from around 6.5 to 8.7 million years ago. Again, right when Earth was going through some big climate changes. So they think there's a small chance that nearby stars, after their fiery deaths, might have affected the climate here on Earth, but they don't have much more evidence for it yet. Then last week, scientists analyzing data from NASA's Advanced Composition Explorer probe found evidence that more iron-60 has been raining down on us for the past 17 years from supernovae a couple hundred light years away, but only at a rate of one nucleus per year, which is not enough to do very much at all, and definitely not enough to hurt us. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow Space News, and thanks especially to our patrons on Patreon who help make this show possible. If you want to help us keep making content like this, just go to patreon.com/scishow, and don't forget to go to youtube.com/scishowspace and subscribe.
We might be getting a little closer to making interstellar travel a reality, just not for humans. Last week, Russian entrepreneur Yuri